number 9, Nechama Tec.
All right, as I'm continuing, so you have those, but I would like to see you, for you to see the interdependence between these different forces and conditions. And one of them, there were six, right? One of them is this individuality that I refer. The reason why I don't refer to it as marginality is because marginality is negative connotation. So let's call it individuality. Then independence, okay? And then an enduring long history of doing good deeds. Mm-hmm. Matter-of-fact perceptions of this rescue, of what they did. They never brag about it. In fact, if somebody would brag to me too much, I would suspect that they are not real rescuers. Mm-hmm. So they see it as a matter of fact, in a matter-of-fact way. Just simply, this was my duty. I had to do it. There was nothing special. In addition to this, it was not done after they have thought rationally. They have, you know, that they were considering the pros and the contras. They were not worried about what could happen. They just did it either spontaneously or gradually. They entered into this kind of behavior. And last but not least, they all shared what I refer to as they had universalistic perceptions about the victims. In other words, they did not see a Jew in it. Some of those people that were rescuing Jews after the war, they were helping, let's say, Polish underground members that were haunted and that were in danger because the Russians were trying to arrest them or act against them. So some of them, very easily, they moved from rescuing Jews to rescuing AKA members. Maybe some of these AKA members were, during the war, in opposition to the Jews, but that doesn't matter to them. They were in need now, they were rescuing them now, and so it goes, you know, throughout their lives. So there are those six characteristics.
Is there something to be said today, with today's genocidal events, about the study of this period of rescuers? Is there something that we should look for?
Yes, of course. Yes, I think it is very important. I find it extremely significant that these people don't look in any exceptional way. What does it mean in terms of young people? When they hear about those wartime rescuers, those heroes, as we regard them as heroes, they have no problem identifying with them. You see, you have problems identifying with somebody that looks extraordinary, but it is so very easy to identify with them because they are like you and I in many ways, in terms of looks, in terms of behavior, in terms of their attitudes to life. They may get angry, some of them are thieves, some of them are, you know, maybe many other things, but they have this something that they share. So that is very important. And in terms of today, yes, I think in as much as you have all kinds of social upheavals all over the world, unfortunately, different genocides that happen, and it is very important to think about it. Well, maybe within those situations, there are some people that rise to the occasion. You know, many of these people, the rescuers, were simply ordinary people that would have lived their lives if it were not for the war, doing nothing. Some of them were peasants, some of them were highly educated, some of them were even had no education whatsoever and would have lived out their lives quietly. It is the situation that made them rise to the occasion. So extreme disasters, unprecedented disasters like the Holocaust, give rise to expressions of extreme rare expressions of extreme goodness and expressions of evil. And it is amazing to see. I think it is probably, and it should be sort of gratifying to us that in this sea of Jewish destruction, which we refer to as the Holocaust, there were some people that rose above the situation and were willing to risk their lives to save Jews. I think in general, for posterity and for history, it is important that the world should realize that not everybody wanted to kill the Jews. There were probably many more rescuers than we think or than we know about, you know. And it is important historically, both for our children to know, the Jewish children and non-Jewish children, and for the anti-Semites to know that there were some people, and I must say some of them anti-Semites, I write about it in my When Light Pierced the Darkness, some avid anti-Semites during the war rose above their hate and devoted themselves to rescuing Jews, risk their lives in order to do that. So it's very important for the world and for the anti-Semites to know that there are people that are willing to sacrifice their life for us. And that is very important. Not everybody wants to kill the Jews. Some people respect us, like Mark Twain. He thought that the Jews were great. I don't know if you saw, you know, here he left a beautiful essay on the subject, and I think this is what we should instill in the younger generation as well.
Do you then find a correlation of the interest you have in the partisans with rescuers? You said there was in the sea of Jewish destruction, there were those who stood apart, and so is that in a sense why this interest in the partisans developed for you?
No, let me tell you this. I'm very fortunate. I'm one of the few that are so fortunate, and I don't know how it comes, that there is a great deal of continuity in my work. One work leads me to another, and another, and another opens the door. And in fact, sometimes it opens several doors, and I cannot deal with the topics all the time. So I leave it for later. I don't know if I will have time to do it. But my own personal story led me to discussion of rescuers and survivors and developing sort of a set explanation of who the rescuers were and how they came about doing what they were doing. When I worked on the research project about rescuers, and I still remember it, I worked in the Jewish Historical Institute in Warsaw in the archives. And I was examining two groups, Jewish survivors that survived on the Aryan side, either by hiding or passing, and Christian rescuers that were risking their lives in order to save Jews. As I was working on those two groups, I came upon a person called Oswald Rufeisen about archival testimony. And he was a man that fit into both groups. He was a Jew that survived by pretending to be half German and half Polish. He, through a set of unusual circumstances, he ended up working in a German gendarmerie in Mir, in Belarusia. In this capacity, he had access to all kinds of secrets, German secrets. And he decided, before he took on the job, he decided, he worked there as an interpreter. He decided that he will take the job on condition for himself if he is going to use the job in order to help, and help anybody, not only Jews, anybody, all prospective victims of the Germans. And this is what he did, and this is what he devoted his life to it. And I did research for a book about him, which took me also about 7 years or so. Before I end the book, I start another one. I do research on the other and another. So I interviewed him for about 7 years, twice a year, and people around him, and I published a book in The Lion's Den, The Life of Oswald Rufeisen, also published by Oxford University Press. Then I asked myself, as I was working on his, how come I did not, as I was working on his case, and I saw that a Jew could be both a survivor and a rescuer, how I asked myself, how come I divided them into two? Because as I began to think of the fact that a Jew could be both a survivor and a rescuer, indeed I found many cases of Jews that while on the run, while they were trying to save themselves and while they were trying to survive, they also were saving others. And this is how I came upon the case of Tuvia Bielski, who was a Jewish peasant in Belorussia, who was a man with very limited formal education, but self-taught, extremely charismatic, who was very independent, who ran away from his village, never joined a ghetto, never let himself become an inmate of a ghetto, which was in itself very unusual. He knew the area in which he lived. He knew many Belorussians who were his close friends. And as soon as he settled a little bit in this Aryan world, he brought in different members of his family and different friends. And as his situation became, looked to him a little bit safer, at the same time, while the Germans were stepping up their process of destruction, he became aware, much more aware of what happens to the Jews. And this is when he decided, and he with his three brothers, they formed a formal small partisan group with less than 40 individuals. And as soon as they formed it, he was, because he was the oldest of the brothers, and also the most capable, but just so by chance, he one of his first orders was that we must save as many Jews as possible. In other words, he was determined to save as many people, Jews as possible. And I interviewed him 2 weeks before he died. And when I did, after we finished the interview itself was very interesting because he was very sick at the time. I said to him, Tuvia, after 2.5 hours or so, tell me what made you decide that you are going to devote yourself to rescuing Jews rather than to fighting the Germans? His group assumed a dual role. They were both partisans that were fighting the enemy, but they were compelled and totally devoted to rescuing. And I asked him the question, what gave you the idea? He says, it's very simple. For him, things were very simple. He says, it's simple. You know, he says, the Germans killed anybody. Good Jews, bad Jews. Why should I imitate the Germans? Should I kill bad Germans, good Germans? What is it going to give me? I have to be my own man. They kill, I save. They focus on killing, I focus on saving. It's very simple, he says. Why should I imitate them to do the same thing as they did? What does it give me? And he would always say, it is much more important to save one Jew, one old Jew, he said, which in those days was worthless according to the German precept. It's much more important to save one old Jew than to kill 20 Germans, if given a choice. And in fact, his group grew to over 1,200 individuals. He saved over 1,200 individuals. There are disputed some of the figures. Some say 1,295, some say 1,235, and over 1,200. Most of them were women, older people, and children. Precisely those that nobody wanted and that had no chance of making it. Sometimes vigorous young men had a better chance if they were willing to join some partisans, and some partisans were willing to accept them. But in his case, they didn't. Now, so he is really a person that assumed the dual role, his group did, of rescuers and resistance fighters, both fighters and rescuers, and saved so many lives, which is a very tremendous thing. As I was working on his case, on this group and the surroundings and the partisan movements, because the book really deals with the partisan movement in Belorussia, which was the center of the Soviet partisan movement, although there were other groups, and I discussed them as well. As I was working on this, I noticed that the fate of women, Jewish women in the forest, was very different from the fate of Jewish men. Different in many complex and fascinating ways. And so in the book, when the partisans, which is really it's titled Defiance, the Bielski Partisans, I devote one chapter, although I talk throughout the book, because they glare at me, the different instances of women, and they demand my attention. I look at them, but then I devote an entire chapter, the fate of women, and the fate of women in the forest. And the fate of women in the forest was very different from the fate of women in the Bielski unit, because the Bielski unit had an open-door policy. He accepted anybody, regardless of sex, age, and state of health, or any other characteristics. So the door was open for all women that could go in. This was not true for the other partisans. Only certain types of women were accepted, and a very small number. Women that looked well and were beautiful and were willing to become mistresses of the commanders. Now, how many of us look so beautiful? Very few that qualify. How many were so young and in such good shape that they were that the commanders desired them, and how many women wanted to become, pay the price for survival. So very few women had a chance to make it in the forest. And they were not accepted. Also, a few women that were doctors were accepted into as doctors, because there were very few doctors in the forest. There was a shortage, so they were willing to take doctors. They were also willing to take nurses, because, again, they didn't have doctors, so they took at least nurses. So the situation was very different for women. And that led me to my next book will deal with gender during the Holocaust, but not only in the forest, but what happened to women in different settings that women lived in. They lived in ghettos, they lived in concentration camps, they lived on Aryan side, they lived in forests. What happened to them in undergrounds, different undergrounds? How did the situation compare of the women and men? Some environments were sort of more conducive more to women, was much easier. For example, on the Aryan side, it was somewhat easier for women, because while the men had this identifying sign of circumcision, women didn't have it. So if they were well-versed in, let's say, religion, or if they would not be overwhelmed by the questioning and so forth, they could get out of it. And many did, after interrogation, even though they were arrested. I mean, some did. How many, we don't know, because figures, for precise figures, that's why I was always smiling when you asked me how many of this, quantifying is very difficult to have precise figures for the Holocaust, and we constantly reevaluate them as new evidence comes about. But I am convinced that we will not know till the very end, let's say, how many passed and how many survived one way or another way. It's very difficult to know precise figures. Many of the people disappeared and died, and we don't know what their experiences were during the Holocaust. And as one title of a book that was published 1946 or 1947, I did not interview the dead. You know, you can't ask the dead and interview them. So it's very hard to know. But I don't think figures tell us as much. I think the events speak to us, and we have to look at the events and listen to them and try to see how they fit into with each other, and what do they tell us together and separately, and how do they illuminate different problems that we are interested in.
How is your family, you have two children, how has your family, your husband, taken your celebrity, so to speak, as far as the subject matter? How has this been for your family? All of a sudden you find yourself immersed in this period of history as an author, as an historian. What has that been like for your family?
Oh, I think my husband has always been very supportive. You know, when I decided to go for a PhD, he always, when I said, no, I cannot have a PhD, I'm not smart enough, he would say, if you don't want the PhD, you don't have to have it, but if you want it, you better get it, because it is not, because you're not so smart. So he has been, I must say, very supportive over the years about me. I think my children probably like the fact that, but my children only learned about me, actually, after the right years. I never talked to them in detail about anything. In fact, my son read Dry Tears, and he occasionally looks at it again and again. But he would read it, and as a teenager, and he said, "Oh, Mom, I thought you won't make it. I know you got so involved. He thought that I won't make it." So I think they are involved, and I hope my grandchildren will start reading it soon. Because some children of 9 have read Dry Tears.
So then up to that point when it became more discussed at home, for instance, how did you decide to raise your children as far as your Jewish tradition? You decided, was your son bar mitzvahed? What was the...
My son was bar mitzvahed. My daughter was not bat mitzvahed. I am not, you know, I am ethnically Jewish. I don't, you know, that's, I am not very much involved in conventional religion. I guess I was a member of a temple. I am still a member of a temple because I promote sort of, I think I would like Jews to know about their background and about their history and their religion and so forth, but I'm not very much upset or involved if they do believe or don't believe. I guess I'm my father's daughter, probably.
And then what was your husband's role with your children?
In terms of what? In terms of religion? He's not a very religious person either, but he's traditionally oriented. And so we, you know, there's nothing, we don't make a big fuss over being Jewish or not, you know, we are Jewish, that's what we are, and we welcome it and we don't make a fuss over it.
Do you think that survivors have a greater responsibility in conveying a continuation of Jewish life? Is there more of a urgency then?
I think that survivors have an obligation to be honest about the history, to try as much as they can to recapture what happened to them and to tell their story. This I feel very strongly about. As far as Jewishness that has to do with religion, no, I'm opposed to any fanatics. Whether these are Catholic fanatics or Jewish fanatics or Muslim fanatics, people should be free to talk, to do what they want themselves, but should not impose their views on others. That I'm very much opposed to. That I'm fanatic about. But that's, you know, my hang-up. I think people should feel free to believe what they want, as long as they don't harm anybody else, not at the expense of somebody else. That really my father taught me. Whatever you do, not at the expense of somebody else. That was his motto in life. If you don't harm someone, fine.
You mentioned earlier that you returned to Poland as early as, what, 1978? When was the first time you returned to Poland after you established your life in the United States?
I returned to Poland after I finished really the right years and began to study to write the next book, which is When Light Pierced the Darkness, to collect material. Much of the material I did collect in Poland. So it was probably 77, 78, something like that. Since then, I was several times in Poland in connection with my work. I guess your next question will be, how was it? It was on different levels, occupationally, as far as a person, a researcher, it was very fascinating and very rewarding. And I met some wonderful people, particularly the rescuers that I interviewed. I'm very much in awe of them, although they don't like me to be, but I am. But on a personal level, when I went to my own city, Lublin, I wanted to run away because I had a feeling that I was sort of viewing a graveyard. I don't know what I had. I couldn't find things and I couldn't relate to things. And I probably imagined them differently, you know, and I was bothered by it. So I never went back to Lublin. I just went once and I have no desire to go there again. But to Warsaw and to other places I go, and I always learn something, and I meet very fine people, and I'm sure I benefit from each of my trips there.
What do you enjoy doing now with your life? What fuels you most now? What do you enjoy doing most now?
Writing, doing research, explaining things to people, teaching those that don't know about certain things. I don't want to convert them to anything. I just want to tell them. I try not to evaluate. I just tell them the way I see it, and maybe right or wrong. I love when my students talk. I stimulate their discussions tremendously in my classes. You know, I teach. I'm a professor of sociology. And in all my classes, I stimulate discussion, and I love it when they question me, when they don't agree with me. That's when I like it the most.
We're going to continue for one more second about that thought. Hold on 1 second. This is tape number 10, Nechama Tec. What questions have been the most debated, or what kind of questions are those that students bring up? That
very often they are questions of a personal nature. They want to know what my relationship to God is and to religion, or they want to know if I feel guilty. That I survived. They want to know what I think about rescuers, who stands out in my mind. All kinds of questions. Mostly it is really personal questions that they ask when I talk about my own experiences. But other than that, they really ask about how it could happen and what do I think about. We certainly address issues about the generality and the specificity of the Holocaust. How does it compare and how does it relate to other forms of genocide? This is very important, and I think we ought to talk about those things. And of course, specific questions that deal with my areas of expertise, which is what about hidden children? What's the history of hidden children? Were the hidden children different from other children? You see, we hidden children were, in a sense, we were always told that we were special, especially in the sense that in some way we were selected to be alive. Now, sometimes this selection did not succeed. Very often, those that were destined to pass or be hidden did not make it. But we were always told that we were different, but in positive ways, because they felt that we had a chance of making it, or they were hoped that we had a chance of making it. And again, how many perished that were destined to survive this way, and how many didn't, we don't know. We only know that consistently, if you look at there were 1.6 million children in pre-war Europe. Okay, an estimated, and we're talking only about estimates, we don't know precise figures. It is estimated, according to some estimates, 1.5 million Jewish children were murdered. So, which means that very few children survived. While we estimate that there were about 9 million Jews in pre-war Europe. And then the estimate, most common estimate, of Jews that were destroyed fluctuates between 5 million to 6 million, which is about 33% or so. Okay, but if you look at the children, the percentage is 6% less than that compared to that. Now, in each country, we have estimates about the survival of the Jews in general, then we have the survival of the children in this country. In each country, the categories differ somewhat, because, you know, one is based on children from 14 to 0, one is based on children from 0 to 10, and so forth. So each has a different set of categories that it uses. But regardless of the categories, if you compare the proportion of Jews, the estimated proportion of Jews that survived in different countries, to the proportion of children that survived in this country, no matter how you divide them in terms of what age categories, always consistently, are you following me? Consistently, fewer children survive than in every country, than the population at large. So, even if the estimates, we made, some of them are more trustworthy than others, or the estimates differ, or their validity differs, and so forth. Nevertheless, consistently, it goes in the same direction. For Jewish children, in Poland itself, the estimate is 5,000 survivors, which is very small. Let's say it is, we are off. But by how much can we be off? You know? So compared to the population at large that we think survived, which is an estimate between 50,000 to 70, 80,000, depends with whom you talk. If you talk with Polish historians, they will tell you it is much more. If you talk with very nationalistic Jewish historians, they will tell you it is much less. The truth probably lies somewhere in between. An estimated 70,000 probably Jews survived in Poland on the Aryan side, maybe.
You mentioned before in the off camera that you were at the Hidden Children Conference.
Yes.
In 1991, I think it was.
Yes, I was there. I was chairing a meeting. Yes.
Was that experience what you thought it would be? What was that like for you? I've heard from many different people who were there.
I wear two hats. I did not participate there as a survivor. I did not. I didn't come there to make connections. I did not come there to tell them that I was a survivor. I don't even know if I identified myself, although they know that I am. I don't hide it. But I came there as a scholar. So for me, it was not really a typical reaction as it was for people that there are some, especially hidden children that survived on the Aryan side, for whom it is very difficult to move from one, it was very difficult to move from being a Christian to being a Jew. You know, first we were asked to give up our Jewishness before we moved in. If we were successful, if we gave it up successfully by playing the part very well, by not being denounced, I was never denounced myself personally. If you played it very well, right, then after the war you were asked to go back, become a Jew. Now why should I become a Jew? Why should a child that was, let's say, protected by a Christian God, and some of them were baptized, and some of them didn't have parents. Some of them lost everybody, you know, and they survived, let's say, in a convent. And they were baptized as a Catholic, and they believed in it, and they saw Jesus Christ as the Savior, as somebody that helped them, because their God couldn't protect them at all. They had to give him up. After the war, this child was asked to go back. So some of us had very mixed experiences, mixed feelings. Am I a Christian? Am I a Jew? Why should I like the, you know, if they were religious at all, either way.
Were you going through that
early? No, I was not. But I was fortunate because there were very few children that had their parents that survived. And I had a sister, and I had really support. But if I were alone, I don't know. I was not going through, and I was not as keen on the divisions anyway to begin with. You see, I thought God liked everybody. Why should He not like me? Did I do anything wrong? No. And I thought those stories that they told, you know, that about Jews were all lies. I knew they were lies because the men I trusted told me so, and I knew they were lies. So why should I believe them? So, but other children, not surprisingly, till this very day some of them have back and forth thoughts, but they don't talk about it. They will talk to me about it, they do. But they don't talk to usually to they're not as free with this. I don't know if you had any, maybe you had experiences, but I know some definitely tell me, well, you I can tell, but I wouldn't tell it to somebody because you will understand. I do, because I partly went through it. But I was not so keen on religious divisions anyway, you know, or distinctions and stuff. And I never thought that this is the only answer for no one, you know. So I think probably I'm not a typical case. I don't know if there is such a thing as a typical survivor.
Why is it? Then you haven't been interviewed before for an oral history project. Why did you finally decide to? Why did you decide to share your story with me today?
I decided to share my story maybe because I'm getting older, and I feel a very strong obligation that people ought to know the history. I know that some people don't, either they don't know, or they have difficulty expressing themselves. And I have interviewed all kinds of people. So most of them I find fascinating. But here and there, I find cases that I don't, you know, that I don't think are just exactly, you know, present the situation as they really experienced it. And so I do feel, as I get older, I feel an obligation. I hate for it to sound so pompous, but I do feel an obligation to the dead. that maybe, you know, I have to tell it. I was reluctant, and I still am a little bit reluctant, because in my case, you know, I'm so immersed in the literature and in the research, and in the, all my, you know, work really centers around Holocaust research, that I am, I find it sometimes difficult to know for myself whether I'm telling you, speaking from the historical perspective of what I have learned, what I have absorbed through my years of study and what I'm still absorbing, or am I talking to you from about my personal experiences as a survivor. That's why I tried in this, certainly, I hope I succeeded. I tried to keep it to the personal very much in the bulk of this discussion. But I will always, you know, I don't trust myself so much. Was I able to keep, or was I, when did the professor enter and when did the survivor, you know?
Well, let me ask you then, would you have preferred 30 years ago not to have approached the subject? What do you think, do you feel that this was the right thing for you to kind of evolve into?
No, I did not make myself clear at all. I have no regrets whatsoever. I'm very happy that I did the work that I did. My only regret is that the 3-4 books that I have in my mind, I probably won't have time to complete, because it takes me a long time to write a book. So that's not, my only regret is that I won't do enough, but not that I did it. I am very happy that I did. I was answering you, telling you why I didn't want to be interviewed. The reason why didn't want to be interviewed, because I was not so sure whether I will be keeping separately the division between my personal and my scholarly knowledge that I acquired throughout the years through my research and through my work. That's the only reason. I didn't want to give you something which you didn't come for. You know.
Well, and then I wanted to ask, do you find it surprising that this has been your choice now to focus on this?
It has been my choice, but most I did agree. I did not agree right away, because when she called me from California, her name is Yagoda, right? Mm-hmm. A lovely person, very nice on the phone. I told her right away, no, I don't want to. I cannot be interviewed. I don't want to be interviewed. I never give interviews. I refused Yale. I refused all the others. And she said, she was very nice and probably very smart, because she said, well, you know something, can I just leave with you my number? We are finishing off in May. That's what she told me. That's our finishing. If you should decide to change your mind for any reason, we would be happy to do it, you know, at your convenience. So I was and I told her, I had to prepare a paper. I was going to Berlin, and I was extremely pressured to finish some papers that I promised. And of course, I'm writing this book that I tried to finish too, and I have a deadline. So I told her, well, all right, I'll take your number, but I don't know if you will hear from me or not. And then when I came back from Berlin, I guess it went so well, and I was so very pleased with the research that they are doing at this particular university that I was invited at, and I was very touched by the fact that there was an island. I realize it is only an island, headed by Wolfgang Benz in Berlin. It is an institute for the study of anti-Semitism, and they are doing such excellent work. And I was so touched by it and so happy by it that, you know, I felt a little bit elated. And they had me there as an expert to give them some help on the study that they want to do of righteous Christians in Germany. And so when I came back, I said, oh, what the heck? I mean, you know, if I wait another few weeks, the whole project will be gone. And my husband felt that I should. He says, why shouldn't you do it? So here I am. That's your answer. I guess it's nothing very profound. It's just that and I'm glad I did it. I don't know. I have to see the tapes. Maybe I wouldn't be glad once I look at it. Who knows?
Well, I'm glad you did. Thank you so much, Nechama.
Thank you. And you were a very good questioner. Thanks.
Thank you.
This is my photo. I think it is approximately 1947.
Taken where, you think? Germany?
It was probably taken in Germany, yes. Mm-hmm. This is Nechama Tec, my photo. It was done probably late in 1947. If I'm not mistaken, the photo was made in Paris when I was visiting. This is my picture, Nechama Tec and Leon Tec, probably right after we were married in 1949. This is my picture, Nechama Tec, and in the background is my friend Ada Tal. And it was done in Israel, I think probably around 1950. And this is a photo from the wedding of my sister, Giza Agmon, with her husband, Dr. Agmon. And my father is on the left-hand side. And my mother, my whole family is actually there. I cannot see from far. But it was probably done in 1951 or 52. I'm not sure when exactly. And this is Nechama Tec with her two children. Next to me is Roland Tec, my son, and Yora Tec, my daughter. And it was probably done in 1967. Something like that. I'm not sure. Never sure.
Maybe a little higher?
Maybe 68. I don't know. This is my father, Roman Bavnik. It was shortly before he died. He died when he was 62, which is so that is in 1966. No, 1965, sorry. And this is my mother, Esther, probably 1965, 67, I don't know. This is Leora Tec, my oldest daughter, and I guess this is her picture. Probably she's 31, 32 in this photo. This is my younger son, Roland Tec. This was probably when he was 25. This is my oldest grandchild, Liam Gundersman. And he's here, I guess, less than two, or maybe just two years old in this photo. And this is my second grandson, and his name is Rome Gundelsman, and he's a year and a half here.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.